Chapter 13, Section 13.3 is on the nature of solids. In the background is a sculpture representing the unit cell of iron. And you can actually climb up into these spheres. This is located in Brussels and it was built in 1958. So by the end of this section, you'll know what a unit cell is and a little bit more about this structure. So solids, as you probably know, have an orderly arrangement of particles. And they're in fixed positions. To remind you about melting and freezing points, the melting point is when a solid gains energy and goes to a liquid, and the freezing point is when that energy is removed and goes back to its lattice form as a solid. Crystal structure and unit cells. The type of bond between the particles in the solid determines the melting point. So a diamond has very strong bonds. It melts at a very high temperature of over 3,000 degrees Celsius, while ice melts at 0 degrees Celsius. There are seven shapes that I'd like you to know for our basic crystal systems, and we're going to designate the edges A, B, and C, and the angles alpha, beta, and gamma. And this is just meant to be a basic introduction to crystal systems. So the first crystal system is the cubic system. I have a sample of galena pictured. Notice the nice cubes that it expresses. All sides are equal and all angles are 90 degrees. In a tetragonal, all your angles are still 90 degrees, but one of your sides is not equal to the other. In an orthorhombic crystal, your angles are again 90 degrees, but none of the sides are equal in length. In a monoclinic crystal, your alpha and beta are 90 degrees, and they are not equal to your gamma. Now, if to notice which is alpha, beta, and gamma, your alpha is the angle between A and B, your beta is between B and C, and your gamma is between A and C. None of your sides are equal in length in a monoclinic. The mineral gypsum expresses this crystal shape. In a triclinic system, none of your angles are equal and none of your sides are equal. In a hexagonal crystal, tourmaline exhibits a hexagonal shape. Your alpha and beta, so alpha is between A and C this time, beta is between A1 and A2 in this one, and your gamma is 120 degrees. Your A and B are equal to each other, but C is a different length. In a rhombohedral crystal, and calcite expresses a rhombus, your alpha, beta, and gamma are not equal to 90 degrees, and your sides are equal. So each of those crystal shapes have unit cells for them. And the unit cell is just the simplest and smallest structure that repeats itself. So the first one is a simple cubic unit cell for cubic crystals. And notice that the dots represent atoms. They're at each vertex. And the mineral or element, polonium, expresses a simple cubic unit cell. This one with the red balls is a space-filling model, just to give you a different idea of how it could be represented. Our second unit cell for a cubic crystal is a body-centered cubic. You might recognize the adium structure in the bottom right. This is just a scale model that they made, and now it's in a garden for people to see. this body centered, you have an atom in the center, and then again you have atoms at each vertex. And iron expresses the body centered cubic. Sometimes they call it a BCC for body centered cubic. And cesium chloride also expresses a body centered cubic unit cell. Our third and final type for cubic crystals is called a face-centered cubic. Notice the atom is now on the face of the cube, in the center of it. And sodium chloride expresses a face-centered cubic unit cell. So if you just look at this outside of the space-filling model, notice in this model we have the vertices are chloride, the big red ions, and in the center is another chloride ion. So those are the three unit cells that I'd like you to know. Now the other crystal shapes do have unit cells, and if you go on to study at an upper level, or if you study mineralogy, say you're a geology major, you might learn those in those classes. Another term that applies to solids is the term allotrope, and an allotrope refers to solids that exist in more than one form. So we're going to look at allotropes of carbon, and I have three examples for you. The first one, you know what a diamond is, and a model is depicted in this picture. It has a very strong structure, very high melting point. But carbon can also form into graphite. If you look at graphite, we have hexagonal crystals across the top, and these form a layer. And this longer bond is a weaker bond between the layers. So when you write with your pencil, you're breaking this weak bond. Between these carbons, this bond is super strong, and actually the Nobel Prize in Physics was awarded to two gentlemen who investigated these properties. I believe they were both Russians, but they did their work at the University of Manchester, and it's called graphene. And it's still in the experimental stages. They haven't applied it to anything yet, but at this point it's one of the strongest structures known. Another structure is Buckminster fullerene, which is carbon 60, and these are all carbon atoms with, and it's like a soccer ball, say, and it's hollow in the center. Named after Buckminster, who made the first geodesic dome. I think I'm correct on that. Another term that applies to solids is amorphous, and this is just something that lacks an ordered internal structure. So you're not going to see a unit cell, you're not going to see a crystal lattice. Even if it's allowed to grow slowly, it's not going to take on a crystal form that you recognize. And I'm going to end the slideshow with just a couple of structures made out of glass, which is an amorphous solid. These are, this is a sculpture by Cicciulli, an artist who has this structure in a museum, and these are all glass. And another structure, this one's in Las Vegas at the Bellagio, and I guess it's along the ceiling, and it overhangs the reception area. So when you check in, if you ever get to go there, check it out and think, oh, chemistry, it's an amorphous solid.